So naturally, unfortunately, in some ways, gratefully, it evolved into me being better running and how it puts people and how people implement it. So I've got a couple of biomechanics for their education. So I've delivered the biomechanics training course, a 2-day course that people can look on and have a little introduction to what you guys do or what you guys do. And I also have a program called Pre-Comp 3, which is an athlete relationship or an athlete care management company. Just started it, it's becoming very interesting into how we give everyday athletes the ability to source this kind of information, because as you probably are aware, not every athlete has an amazing team around them, especially if they are funding themselves. They don't have that capacity to employ the best physio or the best osteo or the best chiropractor or the best masseuse. So we have a massage every week. So we're looking at creating a charity register. It's going to hopefully be launching the next couple of weeks, where every single athlete who can't, isn't under any lottery funding, can hopefully access some kind of education. So it's the kind of service around the week. That's the big picture. It may take a couple more months, but that's the idea behind it. So if you're interested in getting involved, which we do. This is purely from my own memory. So I'm a semi-professional Thai boxer. I've got a fight on the 31st of October. So I'm currently losing weight in a minute. So I forget going to stay on the distance for some time. It's because of too many shots on the head. So if you want to come here on social media, most of them I'm on AKA_Fletch. Pre-Comp 3 is going to launch quite soon, so I wouldn't probably just yet coming there. But it'll be launching soon. So, without further ado, we're going to start with the history around running, around our history as a species, and also we're going to go into the running itself, the mechanics of, etc. We're going to look at some sort of research, the mechanics that they tested in the labs, looking at shock, looking at the injury, because a lot of the claims around barefoot running is around the injury prevention capacity. Does it help reducing, or is the other side of it, does it promote certain other injuries? So we're going to discuss that in a bit more. And what is right for your client? Because ideally, that's what we all boil down to. Is what's the right thing to do for the person's injury? Yeah? Excellent. Okay. So, a couple of weeks ago, we were roaming the plains looking for food. And if we found it, we'd stab it, we'd eat it, and probably, or pick it off a tree and eat it that way, or we probably wouldn't choose it, but we'd have the nutrition there anyway. And then that was what we call a natural move. We were naturally doing what we'd done. A couple of weeks later, then this guy called Jim Fix, not to be mistaken for Jim Fix It, that would be inappropriate, but he. This was deemed as the godfather of jogging. So he basically made jogging be the next fitness fad. Bear in mind there wasn't a fitness fad before that, this was the first fitness fad. He launched a huge amount of charity jogging scene. Unfortunately, he died of a heart attack while jogging, which was funny because he was promoting the health benefits of jogging. I came across this guy through Martin because he died unfortunately 1 year before. So naturally I saw more educated. So this kind of massive scene kicked off around getting out there and getting running, getting the health benefits. And from that, the shoe manufacturers and sports kit manufacturers started to latch on, and we started getting companies like Nike, Adidas, Asics, and all those companies creating a tool for people to use in order to go out to people around. So there was a demand, they created this. Interestingly, in 2012, 79% of runners today get injured in any given year. So 8 out of 10 joggers will probably get injured every single year. And bear in mind, Nike have just released a campaign to make running the next biggest sport in the world. I'm pretty sure it's going to probably increase, or at least more people are going to get injured because more people are getting involved. So it could be interesting. We could all be into some big business for ourselves. So obviously when we come to the point of running, there's a huge amount of different ways to run and styles to run. We'll try and demonstrate that through this little video. So you can tell when we actually go out and run, there are a huge amount of people that look different to other people. So you see some people, they'll tend to have their head facing down, they're plodding along. You see some people that look like they're kind of being chased by something behind them, and they're upright. There's a huge amount of variation. Like, a bit like the thumbprints, but every single person is different in the way they present a movement pattern. So the key thing, not really for this lecture, but the key thing for this lecture, sorry, but not the whole Barefoot discussion, is what running style is better. And the two running styles we want to pick up on are the rear foot strike and the forefoot strike. So this is the big discussion around Barefoot running. Because some people will try and give that broad subject a very simplistic answer that forefoot running is the best form of running. And in order to Barefoot run, you have to forefoot strike. And in order to run better, you have to forefoot strike. And that's the kind of discussion we want to play in part. So Barefoot running is an interesting sales tactic for us to get this conversation out there. But actually, what we're going to try and discuss is the difference between forefoot and rear foot strike. Does that make sense? Fantastic. Okay, so I've also got a bit of a chesty thing, so I'll start coughing uncontrollably. Don't worry. So the idea behind the forefoot strike is, foot strike patterns are related to running speeds, which is not something we usually discuss. The percentage of rear foot striking increases with the decreasing of the running speed. So the slower you run, the more likely you are to run with the rear foot strike. Okay. Controversially, you've got the percentage of midfoot strikers increased as the speed increases. So you're more likely to run on your forefoot, midfoot, if the speed starts to increase. You're looking at sort of the race walker versus the Usain Bolt. Okay, the two different extremes. That was in part of the research in 2007, so that kind of makes sense. The slower you run, the more likely you are to land on your heel, and the faster you run, the more likely you are to run on your forefoot. So you want more speed, more propulsive power, you're going to have more reflex from the gastric medius to come forwards, running faster. Okay, so this is the Boston Marathon. These are the two different packs. You've got the elite pack, and we've got the mid-range pack. So the elite runners look something a little bit like this. You see we've got a forefoot striker in the front there, we've got a heel striker in the middle there, we've got another midfoot striker in the middle, we've got a huge heel striker with the right trainers in the middle, and right next to him is the midfoot striker, another huge heel striker in there. So these are elite runners. These are the ones that everyone really wants to copy because they are elite. And we've got cyclists. And we've got the people that we want to be replicating because they're the fastest, right? We then take it as the mid-pack runners. These are the guys running for fun or for better their own PBs. We've got mainly heel strikers. And they're about now, someone comes in, there he is. The barefooter. So those are the two different packs. What do you think the biggest variation is between those two packs? Speed. Absolutely. Speed is the biggest difference. From looking at the running style, like, it's kind of irrelevant when you look at the speeds. So we have the world record for the men's, done by Dennis Kimitu from Kenya in 2014 in the Berlin Marathon. We've got Paul Radcliffe doing it in the London Marathon in 2003, which hasn't been broken yet, that's part. And these are the kind of speeds they're running at. He was running at 13.02 miles per hour for 2 hours and 2 minutes, on average. That's faster than some treadmills go. I did try to make a video of me running this particular pace. It lasts very long, so there's no point in sharing it. So you can try it. And I'll put these speeds up so you can actually get a taste for it if you want to. Paul Radcliffe, at that time, was running at 12.25 miles per hour for a whole 2 hours and 15 minutes. You know, like, it's ridiculous the pace that he's done. Ridiculous. So if you guys do any running on the treadmill, you know how it feels to run at certain speeds and how scary it is to put that little bit extra on. These guys are phenomenal athletes. Probably the world record, right? So let me look at the average pace, or what people try and break is a 3.5 hour mark, and that's like, yes, done it, I've got that mark up there. That's running at 7.99 miles per hour. In 2014, the average of the average pace for every single marathon I ran that year was 4 hours and 21 minutes. That's running at 6.26 miles per hour. So the world record holder is running twice and a bit more faster than the people, the average runner. Are we really expecting the people running 4 hours and 21 minutes to run the same as the people running the world record times? Yes, we can't. We can't, but you can imagine, we can't expect them to run in the same way because they're not at the same speeds. That's one big thing to take into consideration. This is against forfeit striking. Some of the research we found is against it. Research results indicate an improved mechanical advantage in fourth generation for the ankle extensors during push-up phase. Name some of the ankle extensors. The shoe belt. Which one's meant to do that? Gastrocnemius. Soleus. Beautiful. Thanks. You have massive muscles to help extend the ankle. So, actually, some of the arguments say that running an annual forward gives you a better plyometric potential energy. Sometimes we could actually be argued against in this set because they had a better mechanical advantage when they were heel trying. If you imagine a guy landing, everyone can kind of see, if I land on my heel here and then go and load over that and come over here again, bang, and I'm running at high velocity, is that not a dynamic stretch? The gastro. I land here, my body's moving, my foot stays still, my body's moving over my foot. What's happening to gastro from sleds? It's stretching, it's lengthening. What's that? If that doesn't breathe fast, what's going to happen? It's going to try to come forward, it's going to have that stretch reflex. So there is an argument for and against that both situations could give you a stretch reflex. Forefoot striking puts a higher demand upon the forefoot and ankle as compared to the knee. Pretty self-explanatory. Everyone's tried the forefoot striking or barefoot running. Usually you have, oh, I've got these shoes, I'm going to go do a 5k run straight away. And you can't walk very much. You find there's a huge amount of activity in the lower ankle problems can regenerate and so on. So this is put to numericals. We found that barefoot strikers have a huge amount of load going through the knee and hip. Okay. The forefoot strikers have a huge amount of load going through the ankle. And some of the research coming out now actually suggests that the difference between barefoot striking and forefoot striking is exactly equal to where the load is felt. So the amount of load you take off the knee by forefoot striking is placed on the knee. So it's exactly the same load, you just shift it to a different point mark. Does that make sense? Forefoot striking. So, results show that high mechanical stress in shod running for the knee and the joint structures. We've just seen that in numericals, that's understandable, we did that. Minimally shod runners are mostly, but significantly more economical than traditional shod runners, regardless of strike type. That is the most mouthful of the summary to bring ever. That was, of course, by Dr. Biedman. He is probably the biggest name at the minute in producing pro barefoot running research. So if you need to do any kind of further reading, Dr. Lieberman is an interesting guy to listen to. His degrees and his background is completely non-biomechanical or medical related, but he's now more into ancestral history. So he researches the ancestry of the Earth and evolution. But very interesting. But again, everything is like a religious side, have the balanced diet. So basically, I think what you're saying there is that by running on your forefoot actually makes you a bit more economical. Yeah? Okay. So the answer to this is, do we run forefoot or do we run rear foot? Actually, it depends. If you want to reduce knee loads, then probably forefoot striking is a good idea. Blaise Williams talks about that quite a bit. If you want to reduce calf and ankle loads, then probably a barefoot strike is probably better. Simple, right? Well, the idea behind it, obviously, is there's little doubt that the absorb shock better than the rigid shock. Okay, that's pretty much seen across every study that's ever been done, or will be done, I'm sure. But the problem is we need shock. We need it. It's part of the fundamental way that we produce our emotion. So, the sacral, pelvis, and spine are connected through the arms, the legs, and the head, are all functionally interrelated through muscular, fascial, ligamentous interconnections. Yeah? Or, by diagram, we've all seen this before. Yeah, and Thomas Myers and a few other people talk about sling systems and superficial anterior sacrum spiral lines and so on. The whole body's interconnected. We're an integrated system, right? The other guy who talked about this was a guy called Krakowetsky. He presented the 2007 National Fascia Congress talking about how the whole body's linked together. He summarized by saying that Farfan described the fascial channels forces from the neck crest to the upper extremities. We also have Bogdan talking about the laid out, he laid out the precise anatomy of the soft tissue surrounding the spine, and Gleaming clarified the link between the pelvis and the legs. So all three together, that creates an integrated system between the foot and the shoulders, or the head. Krakowetsky also talks about this producing a force against the gravitational field. So we have the energy of the hip extensors lift the trunk against the gravitational field. So we have landed, bang, in order to move forward, you have to engage the extensors to push up and resist that gravity action there. Yeah? That makes sense. So what kind of extensors have you got in your body? What muscles are going to be doing that? Psoas? Yeah. Iliacus? They're going to be extensors, or they're going to be flexors? No. Glutes? Hamstrings? Rectus spinae? QL? You can go on and on by a number of days. So the idea is all those muscles would help you in running. They'll lift you against the gravitational field and get you moving. Okay? In the air, the spine rearranges geometry for landing. So once you've pushed off, you've rotated, you land. As you land again, the spine starts to readjust itself to then land in the perfect symmetry, to then land, absorb the force, and then carry on again. I haven't seen much evidence to suggest, but I felt it the other day I was on the running machine, because I hate running, I've got to distract myself somehow. Every time I landed, my shoulders were square. Every single time. It's something you guys can experiment with, but I'm going to start experimenting with now. Every time I landed, my shoulders were square, and then I'll rotate again to take off, bang, or square, up, bang, or square. So the whole body rearranges itself ready to land. But not only ready to land, but ready to receive this pulse that kicks up from the floor up into your head. This is another thing Krakowetsky talks about, is this pulse during locomotion. The raw pulse is filtered by the legs and the pelvis to feed the spine. The energy pulse must reach the spine at the correct moment and with the right strength. This is key for the role of the legs. So that seems good for a second. So the floor tells the spine that you landed, pretty much. That shock sends signals to the gastroc, through to the hamstrings, to start stabilizing all these muscles and all these joints and all these things that can move, to absorb that, to land, to give you stability in order to move on to the next muscle. So we need that. The key question is how much do we need? How strong should this pulse be? And are there ways we can affect this pulse via the intrinsic mechanics of something? Can this pulse be different from one side to the other? Is that sometimes what we see people running asymmetrically? The one guy who came in and said, oh, I've been told to run 4 foot, I just can't seem to get it. Got him on a trip and told him to completely forget what he was doing. He was running 4 foot, only on his left leg. He was running heel strike as well. He said, I can't seem to get this 4 foot strike. I said, well, you are. Just on one side. So it's really key to remember that sometimes the brain knows best. And it will fight every single part of your conscious brain to override it. if it's dealing with things on the inside that can cause you problems or cause you injury, some things just won't change. So this pulse is something that needs further looking into. How much do we need? Well, this kind of hopefully leads into a little bit of it. I've not seen these videos before. I like them a lot because it shows up force and how they apply. Hopefully just loops. Quickly in place. Swing phase, there's nothing touching the ground, and then bang, heel strike happens, a slow deceleration in that force, and then the forefoot strike, the forefoot lands, and you've got this slow build up of body weight. And then as the person takes off, slowly there's a decrease in force from there. So that'd be a forefoot strike, and then we get back as well. So then you've got the opposite, which is the forefoot strike. And the forefoot strike happens in a much more slow, progressive build up. So you've got this slow, progressive application of body weight. It then peaks. That's usually when the rear foot kisses the ground. And then a propulsive phase happens again, and they push off, and the next swing happens. So this is the argument that a lot of the, I'm not quite sure what to call them without being slightly horrible, but the barefoot, they'll bring up this idea that you don't want to slam that heel into the ground as hard as you can with this sudden increase in force. But the definition of a pulse is a signal, a sudden pulse. That's what we've been designed to absorb. If we didn't, we weren't designed for this particular pulse, we wouldn't have formed a subtalar joint. The subtalar joint allows us to absorb this pulse because of pronation. So pronation becomes a fundamental part of dampening this pulse if we need it to dampen. But absolutely, you do not want to slam your heel very hard into concrete because it really hurts. So I wouldn't suggest trying it, but if you did for the sake of research, go for it. In fact, one guy at the lecture I did here for FitPro said, "Can you stand on the box in the middle of the lecture? Or can you stand on the chair for me?" I was like, "Can you jump off and land on your heels?" I said, "No." Hopefully, I wouldn't be quite running in that kind of trajectory to the springboard. But you kind of get the point. You don't want to be landing on a really hard surface with that bone smashing into the ground. If you watch a lot of the Kenyans in that natural environment, they're mostly running on their forefoot because they're running on hard sand desert environments, or concrete in some cases, playing football without shoes. Does that necessarily mean that we have to then adopt that same thinking because that's our environment and say that's natural for us? Well, probably not, because we are designed to adapt. We are designed to read via our senses what the dangers are of walking through. So you see a bunch of pins on the floor, you don't go, woohoo, I'm going to walk across those pins, you have an instant danger signal. You see concrete, your brain is registering that and going, that's hard, I need to change how I run. Or if you see sand or grass, the brain's going to readjust that and go, that's soft, I'm going to change how I run. Why do you think it has that adaptive nature? Protection. Protection, but also maybe to control the intensity of that pulse. So the spine and the rest of the body receives the right signal at the right strength at the right time. Does that make sense? Interestingly, the video was working. Actually, the same runner puts about an extra 0.2 times body weight or force through into a forefoot strike than he does through the rear foot strike. Which is really interesting, because obviously he's decreasing the amount of force he experiences instantly, but increasing the amount of force he experiences eventually. Could that potentially be because the spine didn't receive enough of a stronger pulse, so that he's now putting more weight through the activity to create that pulse, we are, it's an interesting discussion. So, there we go. So the key thing is how much shock do we need? And the answer is, nobody knows. Simple. No one knows, we can't measure it. It's one of those things that's one of those phantom things that we need to be able to discover first. So the idea is for those who receive too much shock, probably orthotrochic valve, and for those who don't receive enough, orthotrochic valve. So that's unfortunately the most simplistic way to think about it. And that's in some cases where footwear can help. And we'll come on to that in a second. There you go. As simple as possible. The discussion around injuries. The injury side of it, I don't know whether you guys have experienced the news where my brand just got through a big lawsuit because of their claims that they were suggesting about intervention. The lady basically put shoes on, went for a long distance run, got injured, sued them because they didn't deliver on it. I think in the grand scheme of things, it's about $30 million they ended up paying out, which I think was a drop in the ocean for what they were making. But I think up in the more shoes up until 2011, I think you've got a refund. Most of those shoes are probably out now anyway. But people are starting to crack down on this claim issue quite a lot now, especially in the States, obviously. But it needs to be addressed because to suggest that by doing this thing is going to prevent this is unfounded. But there is a logic to it and maybe a system of progression. So can orthotrochic striking help with injuries? Well, against this argument, runners using minimalist shoes should be cautious at the potential need for head alterations from a heel strike to a midfoot strike pattern, as well as caution on the symptoms of stress injury, particularly around the midfoot, the sort of metatarsal fractures that might happen, in some of the mortise neuromas that are starting to be seen, and all those little details that something we're missing. As much as the arguments around, oh, we wouldn't want to have a hammer smacking into your heel, but we want a hammer smacking into my forefoot. Shock attenuation was greater in barefoot striking. Barefoot striking was perceived as a more comfortable running pattern. So actually, some people felt more comfortable to run on their barefoot. So that's against barefoot striking again. There's a lot of research now suggesting the more comfortable you are, the more that's beneficial to you. Nike have now started to change their entire shoe description in stores away from gait analysis, and now put them on the treadmill, we're just saying two things. Do they fit? And do you feel comfortable? Brilliant, fine, all together. Whereas before, we were like, oh, Eric, I need to put a little bit on this side, and I've got like this motion control shoes, and unfortunately, the one day, also went, which is completely great, but now I'm starting to realize that it probably is something. Okay? So that's against, and we have obviously the balance argument of four running. We conclude that suitable increases in step rate can substantially reduce the loading to the hip and the knee, joint ski, during running, and may prove beneficial in the prevention of treatment of common injuries and prevention of injuries. So by decreasing the loads on hip and knee, you actually decrease the risk of injury. Again, pretty self-explanatory. Makes sense. the other one is those who habitually riff a strike had approximately twice the rate of repetitive stress injuries than the individuals who had orthotrochic strike. Again, another one by YouTube as well. It took a load of 12 collegiate runners out on the track and also measured the run over, I think, a three semester season, and which is how they injured. And the river strike has been injured more than the orthotrochic. The problem with it is most of the research we find and see now doesn't take any consideration any of the intrinsic biomechanics. You have to rule out if they're male or female, or if they are left-handed or right-handed, or all these little things, apart from the fact that does it hurt them, or there's something nerves problem, or all these little things that have not, so we know, have a massive part to play. And the answer is, if the client has osteoarthritic changes in the lower limb, or periostitis, inflammation of the periosteum, then it's probably best to author strike. Summary. What's the right for the client? Obviously, we always see any group of patterns, including running, are often compensations for biomechanical problems. We need to screen is imperative. So a lot of the time we're seeing a lot of schools of thought about running, so you'll see like chi running. There's the least active method. There is pose running, and all these different styles that say this is the most efficient way of running. What we saw at the beginning is a load of different styles that everyone has, and it is the oldest sport in the book. So to say that everyone is running wrong, unfortunately, is a little bit like saying everyone is moving wrong. No one's moving wrong, they're just moving in the way that they can. And everyone's running in the way that they can. To tell the room to run differently, potentially, you could be uploading some of these compensatory problems. Intrinsic problems. So some of the discussions, obviously, now this is away from purely barefoot running, we're just running in general, is looking at the intrinsics of running. So you've got, obviously, tight sagging nerve. This can be an issue that you will come across a lot. This original presentation was designed for people who had no idea what biomechanics coaching was. So obviously, you guys have already that one step ahead. If you're not, then look on. The idea behind this nerve is obviously, what is the type of nerve done? What is it like? What are the two things that it really hates? Speed and being stretched. Perfect. What do you think sprinting is? A very fast stretch. Yeah? So if someone is going at a high pace and is lengthening their stride for some reason, then you want to know that they're prepared for that. And a lot of the 4 foot proactivists, not like terrorists, but they're not proactivists, will talk about shortening the stride and landing on the forefoot to make sure the foot lands underneath the body so they can become self-forms. Kind of makes sense, but do we want to shorten everyone's stride without really understanding why they could be running along, or do we want everyone to lengthen their stride, especially when they start sprinting? That's actually going to lengthen the stride out anyway. We want to stop big people run faster if we don't understand how they can break in the first place. We need to know the why first. So I was going to play this video about the perfect aerobic sprinting, but someone got there first. Obviously, that's a prime example of the self-nerve intervening where the hamstrings have to protect. And it happens a lot if you go back to this particular image here. You can see that, especially on the finishing line or any particular stress position, if the person was now to rip the strike in that position here, what do you think that might do to the nerve? It would stretch a little bit more. So there could be an argument there to suggest that if someone does have a really tight sciatic nerve, you might want to encourage them to have a forefoot strike because that will offload the nerve a little bit and you could then lengthen the gait out a bit more to then have the same effect. Does that make sense? Okay. So another intrinsic problem that can occur is about the pronation of the ankle. Obviously, you can see here the pronation of the ankle happens. Obviously, that rotates the knees, it rotates the hip, and so on. If the feet are different for any particular reason, then that could have an impact on their running style. But what if someone can't pronate? They are out there. Yeah. Same here, I've got the most rigid foot in the world. They're not going to have any shock absorption. So what's going to take up that shock absorption? Everything else. The knee, the hip, they might drop into the spine, all these kind of things might happen. So remember that pulse has to reach the spine at the right strength, at the right time. So everything else will be involved down and down. So if people can't shock anymore, there's a good chance maybe for them to forefoot strike. So if they haven't got the ability to pronate, then they might want to dampen that shock down by using the forefoot as a break. If someone hasn't got enough internal rotation, this might be a reason for them to forefoot strike. Why do you think it might be? or internal rotation have a, would be a problem?
Feedback.
looking at some moves on their foot and saying that you're moving wrong and so on. I did some research around putting on barefoot shoes for a month and assisting the Biomechanics every week. I wanted to do that with them. One on a one-day course and listen to them talk and so on, and very quickly realised it wasn't the course for me, because it was all about changing how people run on the first instance and saying that we were all wrong, and I was demonised for wearing my normal shoes, which is quite funny, yeah. But then the next week, I got an email from Martin saying, oh, can you put an article together for BitPro magazine? Okay, put one together, and it was an against argument for his pro on it. So that was quite interesting. So I saw him the next week and he gave me a scowl as if I was spying on him from the inside. But it's the key thing is that no one is wrong. They have a great idea around how to change someone's running to a forfeit strike if you want to change to a forfeit strike. The logic needs to be in place for why you would change it. So as long as you've got your own evidence around the person's intrinsic movement, not biomechanics, you've got your reason as to why they need to change their striking pattern or running style if you, and then you have the correct progression in order to change that in the first place. And no one's going to go from running a marathon in a river striking and just going thinking about this into Tyler Twist, whatever it is, or running down the road, enjoying it, to suddenly thinking about forward striking and breathing and changing the arm position and so on. It's not going to happen overnight. It needs to be a slow progression learning system. And the same way, you're not going to take your shoes off today and start walking around down your plane tomorrow. It's going to cause some kind of adaptive phase. So this is the other key thing is, if you're going to change anyone, give the body time to adapt. And I was going to bring a load of shoes in today, so you can see the different styles, just within one company. Nike is starting to bring out, or have been bringing out, different shoes across about the last decade, all with different heel drops and different cushionings and different balance systems and no flipping nothing in it at all, to suddenly this massive pillow under your foot is all over the place. But actually there's a bit of system to it, in the way that there's a shoe for every single foot type. We just need to work out what that person needs based on what their foot does. That's the next step, is to have a screening system and then a shoe system based on